something that's been on the minds of a lot of biotech investors, but it's one of the hottest areas of investment right now, and that is the Chinese biotech market. So, Simon, I'm excited to dig into this today with you, but let's kind of set the stage, because if you're like me, I kind of look at the Chinese market in some ways like the emerging biotech market in the U.S. in the early 90s. It was rife with problems, really wasn't efficient, and you can see how far we've come since then. But what are your thoughts on what makes China such an attractive investment right now?
Well, it's definitely the perfect storm right now for investors that are interested in this, because there's a bunch of things that the confluence of them all together are just setting the scene for this to be a really big market. What I mean by that, Shannon, is you've got kind of the funding, you've got the policy, and you've got the people in place for biotechnology in China. Regarding funding, 5 years ago, venture capitalists were putting about $1 billion a year into biotech in China. That's now $12 billion a year, so a 12-fold increase in venture capital funding from the private programs that we've seen. But the government, too, is just pushing this as such a priority because they consider it a really big deal over there. Government's putting $1.5 billion, I should say, into 20 different research parks around the country. So they're really encouraging this. They are also encouraging it as part of their 13th five-year plan for biotechnology to account for 4% of GDP. That's a huge base, Shannon, and about double the percentage that America spends on biotech here at home. And this is just something that also, once you have that academic research, you have the government policy in place, it's also got the opportunity for the exits through biotech listed companies on the stock exchanges there in Hong Kong, and then also here on the NASDAQ in the US. So you've got the funding, you've got the policy. But even more than that, the thing that I think I'm most excited about is that the people aspect of this. China has always lagged the rest of the world because the most talented scientists were working with westernized pharmaceutical companies, the Sanofis, the Roches, the Mercks of the world. But China, through their 1,000 Talents program, has been giving incredible incentives to lure those scientists that have clinical trial experience back to the country to work with Chinese-based companies to start progressing their own biotech industry within the country's sovereign walls. So it's really an interesting time. And for investors, there's a lot of opportunity in this industry as well.
Yeah, and just diving more even into the healthcare side, there's a huge market opportunity in China from a healthcare perspective. So China has about 20% of the world's population. It has about 30% of the world's cancer patients and the world's second largest pharmaceutical market. Right now, only 4 of 42 cancer drugs that have been approved globally in the past 5 years are actually available in China right now, which is astounding to me. So the growth opportunity here is tremendous. And you mentioned too, like all the funding and all the money right now that's being poured into China. What you've seen happen a lot is a lot of these Chinese investors have been investing in U.S.-based biotech companies at an increasingly fast rate. So on the U.S. side, now Chinese and other Asian investors make up nearly half of all the deal flow into U.S. biotech companies compared to just 11% in 2016. And that was the 2017 stat. It'll be interesting to see what that looks like for 2018. I suspect it'll be even higher. But what a lot of these Chinese investors are doing, they're pouring money into these U.S. biotechs. They are basically looking to generate returns to return back to China to really build up this Chinese biopharma hub. But at the same time, too, they're wanting to bring back the technology as well. So you see the sharing across the seas here. Also, too, China has a rapidly aging population. You've got an emerging middle and upper class. So you've got some affluence. And the government is actually aiming to ensure all citizens have access to basic healthcare services by 2020. So it's really no wonder why not only is China an interesting investment opportunity, but even more so healthcare in China specifically.
Yeah, and I mean, every one of those statistics is a case in point, right? I mean, let's look at lung cancer. China's got about 36% of the diagnosis of lung cancer in the world. But when you look at the five-year survivorship rates in China, they're 17 percentage points lower than just the global average. I mean, forget about westernized economies. This is a country that's got big pollution problems. They've got higher smoking rates. They have regional issues that need to be addressed. And they're behind the rest of the world. They've got a lot of people and a lot of money, but historically they just have lagged more developed nations in healthcare. And I think that's rapidly changing right now.
I totally agree. So with that, let's kind of turn the tables a little bit, Simon. Let's actually talk about what are the risks involved with investing in China? What are some of the downsides? What are the things that make you pause when you're looking at Chinese biotech investments?
Well, the first, of course, for any Chinese company is the structure, the corporate structure of these companies. These are companies that you can't just go out and buy a Chinese direct equity ownership. You have to buy things called American depository shares or American depository receipts. Those are sponsored by banks here in America that kind of work with the brokerages to secure shares. But they're structured in a way that there's an inherent risk always that if China's government just wants to say, hey, Shannon, we're pulling the plug and you no longer own any equity in this company, there's nothing to prevent them from doing that. These are variable interest entities. These are complex corporate structures that really don't give us the same say in corporate governance as we've gotten used to through proxy statements here in the United States. So there's always a risk for Western investors of that long tail, just losing a stake or having regulations discouraging Western investors at first. And then also something, Shannon, you and I have talked about in biotech and especially in China is regulations. I mean, this is a country that's kind of overhauled their equivalent of the FDA in recent years. In the last two or three years, we've basically seen them uphaul the way that they reviewed new drugs that were coming to market. And there's a lot of uncertainty of how rigid that really is and whether they're progressing the best drugs through trials, through what some people would consider to be much more lax regulations than in Western economies.
Yeah, definitely. I think that's probably the number one red flag when it comes to Chinese biotech is really the uncertainty surrounding regulations. And what I will say is China is certainly trying to take steps to fix that. So they are trying to take their version of the FDA, the CFDA, and actually modernize that entire agency so that it is up to international standards. And so that is certainly a work in progress. You also have a huge backlog of applications. So many of these Chinese biotech companies have been sitting waiting for a response on approval or not for years in some cases. Now you see the government really starting to invest in staffing to help with the backlog. So I will give them credit, say that they are making strides, but that is still a huge, huge area of uncertainty. You want to know that when you're investing in the company, there's transparency, there's accountability, and you understand and can trust the data that comes out of these trials. And that's still, I think, one of the biggest holes in the investment thesis for a lot of companies right now in China, but something to watch. But yeah, I think that, you know, the regulatory framework is another one. In addition to, you always hear stories about Chinese insider trading, questionable financial statements. And so there's a lot to be desired, even on the financial side of things as well. And even on the IP side, their intellectual property protections aren't nearly as strong as they are here in the U.S. And you've got to build out a good insurance network to be able to cover a lot of these drugs, especially expensive immuno-oncology drugs. So still a lot left to be desired there.
Yeah, I absolutely agree.